We can begin. I have the pleasure to introduce the presentation of the book of Daniele and Mastro Giacomo, Days of Fears, of Fear, published by Europa Edition, not Europe, Europa Edition. Usually the people is used to understand have a representation of international politics through, we can say, a structural model of politics in which there are nations that deal, negotiate, or make war against another nation, everything at a macro level. According to me, there are also some interesting studies made in cognitive science, it's very interesting, instead analyzing the decision-making processes at the micro level, how the interaction between individual human being in important moment of decision making, negotiation, elaboration of some strategy and so on, can change the course of action. Then they are not nation against nation, are individual human being that interact with other individual human being. And I think one of the most important interaction in the history of politics is of people that has lived in real term the relationship with some country that is in war or that has had the ability to overcome difficulty in interacting in very difficult conditions like in prison. Le mie prigioni of Silvio Pellico explain much more than many other historical book about the Risorgimento Italiano. And I think it's interesting, important to analyze the book of Mastro Giacomo from this point of view, how you perceive the Taliban culture, Taliban value, apart from the problem of torture and psychological pain and suffering, but in your interaction as a prisoner with someone that is interacting with you, that is bringing their own value, and then show a face, a side that probably the analyst in international politics don't know. Then from this point of view, I think it's interesting, it's original to have the point of view that is contained in this book. In any case, I want only to tell some words about the person that will have this presentation. Daniele Mastro Giacomo is a journalist, Italian journalist, expert in foreign policy. He works at La Repubblica since 1980. He also teach journalism in some university in Rome, Louis and Tor Vergata. He has been he had many experience in war area in the world, in the Middle East, in Africa, and so on. Instead, Rampini is we can say is not full professor in university, but is more than full professor in university in the expertise that he has in some area of the world, in particular China and India. His book were very famous in Italy and before many other academicians introduced the problem of the emerging country that are beginning to be the most important country in the world. And is senior columnist and US correspondent at La Repubblica. Thank you very much. I want only to tell another thing about this chair that is empty chair on the stage, as in every presentation of the Pen World Voice Festival. The chair represents the artists around the world that have been robbed of their right of freedom and free expression. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The director of the Italian Cultural Institute. Daniele, my friend and my colleague, is was born in 54 in Karachi, Pakistan.
Yeah, Pakistan.
So somehow there was a calling since the beginning.
Exactly.
Your destiny was
maybe
written
a signal.
Into. And apart from what the director of the Institute already said, you have been for years now the typical war correspondent, yes. Which is a very, nowadays, controversial definition of a job, very, very controversial job description. We will discuss that later on. But the topic of the book, my summary will be very brief. This is the story of a kidnapping. March 5th, 2007, Daniele was kidnapped while he was covering the Afghanistan war. You were traveling with an Afghan journalist, Ajmal Naqshbandi, and an Afghan driver, Syed Agha. You were on your way to an area of southern Afghanistan controlled by the Taliban after you had been promised an interview with the Taliban commander. And you were, all of you, you, the Afghan journalist, the driver, you were kidnapped by Mullah Dadullah's men. Initially, they believed that you were a British, I think.
Spy.
Then at some point when they discovered, your kidnapper discovered that you were an Italian reporter, they their first official request was that Italy withdraw their troops from Afghanistan. And after Italy had refused, war surgeon and emergency founder Gino Strada contacted the Taliban and in an attempt to free. All of you. Now, I'll jump very, very quickly to the conclusion, although those were for you probably the 15 longest days in your life. After 15 days, you were eventually freed in exchange for the release of 5 Taliban prisoners, including Dadullah's brother, Mullah Shah Mansour.
Yeah.
And other Taliban commanders. And you were able to return to Italy on March 20, 2007. However, your friend, colleague, assistant, Ajmal Naqshbandi, the Afghan journalist, was not freed on April 8, 2007. He was
killed
by beheading. And your driver, too, had the same fate. On May 12, 2007, Mullah Dadullah, as well as 2 of the Taliban commanders who were released in exchange for Daniele, were killed in a US-led action. And I strongly suggest that this symbolical empty seat, which is, as you, as the director explained, a feature of the PENS club events, is also today for remembering Ajmal Naqshbandi, who was a distinguished reporter, Afghan reporter. And he was also deprived of his freedom and of his life.
Exactly.
Now, there will be time for questions from the audience. I will ask only 3 questions. If the audience wants to know more details about those terrible 15 days of your captivity, you are, of course, free to ask. But I would somehow jump already to another question, which is, in those 15 days as a prisoner, you were somehow, if I may use this word, a privileged prisoner, because you were not just kept into a dark hole. You traveled a lot with your jailers, with the Taliban. You traveled, you were able to speak with them. So, and this is one of the topics of the book, yeah. Days of Fear. So, I would like to ask you now, what do you think of the Taliban? Who are they? What is the vision of the world that you were able to take from your dialogue with the Taliban during those 15 days as a prisoner?
Yes, thank you, Federico, to ask me this question. I apologize for my English, it's not so good like Federico, like Joseph Perso, but I think you will be in understand exactly what I say, so you it's better to talk, I think, in English, because the relationship is more closer with the people, so I make an effort about this. The Taliban, the scores that I decided to go in the south of Afghanistan, and exactly for this reason, when they released me, they released with Ajmal Sayed, Ajmali was released also him, and after he was recaptured along the way, and they told me the last day, they say, you know, you come here to make an interview with us, this is more than an interview. And they have been reasoned, because you can imagine, we they cannot put us in a dark room, in a single local, we was chained, we were prisoner, but we arrived to we make with them to surrounding all the south of Afghanistan, the region of Helmand region, and Helmand region is a historical region of the Taliban, because they live there, and also is the main region where they produce and cultivate some big cultivation of poppy cultivation. You know, with the poppy cultivation, they produce heroin. Heroin is the foremost finances of Taliban, and is they was totally owner of this land. They control totally this land, and they explain me you have the right to know exactly which kind of land we have, and how we like to live, and what we want to for our future. What are our dream? We discussed for 2 weeks about justice, about the form of about religion, obviously, and about the relationship with between the person. We discussed about sex, because they were very curious also about all the things that about our world. And it was so different with the word of the Taliban. And in one hand, they were suspect, as it were, they consider me, obviously, a miscreant, so it's not a really Muslim, but also Sayed and Ajmal, who were Muslim, because in Afghanistan there is an Islamic state, but they considered also Ajmal and Sayed like not a really Muslim, because for them to be a really Muslim, they have to applicate exactly the rules of wrote in who has write in the Quran. The Taliban is not a strange person or mysterious person. They born in 1994 as a students, because Taliban is a plural in Pashtun, in Darian Pashtun is a plural of students. Taliban is a singular, Taliban is a plural. They born like students of a religion school named Madrasa. This Madrasa grow in a lot of madrasas along the border between Pakistan and Afghanistan. This area, in the, you know, Afghanistan, maybe you know exactly where it is in the heart of Central Asia, is a poor country. There is no many natural resources. There is many gas and oil in the north, in the ex-republic, Soviet republic, is now is Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan. But it would be always considered a land in the middle between the great game. There is a famous book, Leute von Hopkins, who wrote the big game, the eternal game between the ancient empire from Tsarist Empire from Russia and the empire from the UK, the England Empire, who dominate England, dominate India and Pakistan. And for centuries, for many, many, many years, many centuries, Afghanistan was in the center of this kind of game, but it was also the center of the Silk Route, between the commerce between East and West. And it was a very beautiful country, and he lives for a long period of peace. But for the last 30, 40 years, he was in the center of a big struggle between different clans, different warlords who control different parts of the country. And at the end, as a topic of the struggle, very, 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 very strong, very, very bloody, was destroying this country. A group of religious Afghan religious leader who lives in exile in Pakistan decide to make something. Between them, there was also the Mullah Omar, who became the leader spiritual of the Taliban, and decide to make some form of justice, some form of simple. They go in the village, they started to go in the village, and to create some condition of a new equilibrium, also social equilibrium, social and religious equilibrium. After that, they, with the help of thousands of young person who was studying, growing in this madrasa, they arrived to conquer the entire country. And they remain in Afghanistan. They dominated Afghanistan with their regime for 6 years, since 2001. We know very well what happens in New York, in this country, in 9/11, 2001. It was incredible attempt to the Twin Towers. And obviously, this action was connected with the Taliban, and also it was connected with Al-Qaeda and Bin Laden. Bin Laden was hospitalized by Taliban and protected by Taliban in Afghanistan. So the United States and other countries decide to broadcast his extradition. The Taliban refused to continue Bin Laden, and so started the reaction from United States forces decide with a big coalition composed by 32 different countries, Western countries, but not only Western countries, but also Asian country and African country, to create a coalition against the Taliban. The Taliban was because it was and they retire themselves in the south of the country and return back in the same area where they stay now, where they are born, where they normally live. The Afghanistan for the first 4 or 5 years born again. There was a lot of finances, a lot of form of investment from China, from India, from Pakistan is a country, obviously, all the countries surrounding Afghanistan are influences about on Afghanistan, and so they need the peace, obviously, of this country. But in the same time, there is different interest, so they play on different clan where they control or where there is influence. For the first 3 or 4 years, so since 2004, 2005, the situation was more or less calm. We follow, we cover the other big war, like foreign international correspondent in Iraq. So we remain for a long time also in Baghdad. But at the side, we cover because we were obviously all obliged to cover between, so sometimes Iraq, sometimes Afghanistan. In 2005, I call my friend Ajmal Nashbandi because I read and I note some signal that was demonstrates this changing. It was something strange because they started some suicide bombers and some action by kamikaze. It was not typical from Afghan tradition because the suicide bombers born in the Middle East, normally in Lebanon, and after they sport in Arab country, but in Afghanistan normally there are people of warriors, so they prefer they used to struggle directly on the ground, not use suicide bomber. And I suspect
suicide
bombers, yes. And I suspect probably it was the presence from the new Arab Afghan, so it's a member of this international jihadist who now stay also in Africa, stay also in Somalia, and they used to stay there during the regime of Taliban regime. And Ajmal Nashbandi confirmed me that the situation in Afghanistan was changing, it was growing. And he proposed me to make an interview with big commander, military commander of the south of Helmand region, because it was a region where this coming from, this region, all the Mujahideen, all the warriors, all the insurgents of Talibans. And he told me also it was not particularly dangerous interview because it was one period the same Taliban decide to open to foreign journalists that don't usually they are very closed about this, but they decide. 1 week before that we organize our trip in the south, they release a lot of interview with French, German, and also England, and also American journalists. So it was really, really not a normal, but quite normal, typical interview with a commander, and we planned to remain just 2 days. After that, the situation is we are not alone because after 1 year and a half after our story, I think I remember another journalist of New York Times. Leaves the same situation because it was also his kidnapping. They're changing their plan. Probably they considered exactly in the same days there was starting a new operation on the ground, and so probably with the bombardment maybe they produced some civil casualties or many other problems. So probably the mood and the atmosphere inside the Taliban probably changes. So when we arrive to the appointment as a meeting, we were surrounded by some Talibans and they accused us to be some spies. And we insist, obviously, and say no, because we talk, we're following all the all the scale of in this case, obviously, you talk with a spokesman. It's not you go in the south. It's not a normal trip. We have to plan it very well. The situation. We have to organize a meeting. Obviously, we stay in the front line. So. As it's the delicate appointment, it's not a normal appointment. But at the moment when we arranged our meeting, when we arrive on the ground, exactly the point of the meeting, they decide to arrest us, not to kidnap us. They accuse us, they arrest us for illegal intrusion in the Emirate land of Afghanistan. And also, I remember they say, okay, why illegal introduction, we ask the authorization, they say, no, you have not your visa. And I say, come on, there is no visa for Emirates land Afghanistan. They say, no, there is an embassy in Rome, you have to ask your visa there. They can, no, it's impossible because they don't release a visa for Emirates, Islamic Emirates Afghanistan. They release a normal visa for Afghanistan. So in any case, I think there was also a surprise for our presence, probably the change and the play with us. We remained there for 2 weeks, and during these weeks, I tried to understand these people. And these people were very different from what I supposed before. I read a lot of books about them. There is an author, a very famous author in Pakistan, is also a journalist, Ramed Rashidi, wrote a lot of books about the Taliban. It's very interesting, but there was the ancient Taliban. The new Taliban are different. Little criminal, very young. They live, they used to live all together like a little group. And the family, their family is the same group where they grow together. Before in this madrasa, in the school, they is coming from a poor family, and they know very well the Quran because they study on the Quran. It's the only book that they study. They know this memory in original language, so in Arabic, and they know very well. And obviously, this means they are full, really impregnated of religious sentiment, and they see their life like they applicate all the rules inside the Quran like rules of their life. So it means. There is no woman, obviously, because of woman, they say, because one day I asked them, come on, in your group there is no woman, never, no girl. They say, no, because the woman is an element, the disequilibrate group, so they have a fear about the woman. In the same time, they don't like other kind of book, they don't like music. They don't like watching TV. They don't like all this education, all this culture, because the education and culture is opens the mind of the people. And so if your mind is more open, obviously you open your mind also in the world. And so they think if you look the rest of the world, you risk to be contaminated by the war. And for them, the contamination is all is out of Quran, of application of Quran. I have a lot of men, a lot of friends, Muslim friend, and they are Islamic. They know very well the Quran, but they is depend of your interpreter, your book, or your relationship with God. Is like the law. You can to interpret in one manner or in another manner. Is the interpretation of Quran is very strictly, very, very radical, very closer. They are not open. And just to explain, I think maybe to try to explain what this is. Yes.
Thank you very much, and yes, maybe you will elaborate further if there are questions on
this sure.
topic. I would go to the second question arises from what you just said, your description, rather somber or even sinister description of the Taliban. Now, I would like you to speak about what is happening right now there. You obviously are not sympathizer to their cause.
No.
I think if I remember well, or if I quote correctly, that some of the first words you said when you were freed from captivity were, "I hope that the Taliban will never return to the Afghanistan government." So you are not a suspect of any sympathy.
No.
But right now, well, you pronounced a name which would have been very exotic for an American a few years ago, Helmand Province. Now these names have become very familiar to the American people. So right now, there is a surge in the military presence of the US and their allies in Afghanistan. We, with a somehow less euphemistic term in the Italian press, we write about an escalation decided by President Obama, disappointing some or many of his supporters. What do you think of the escalation? And also, at the same time as the escalation is going on, there is also more and more rumors or even openly discussion of negotiations between the US and the Taliban leader or some of the Taliban leaders.
Yeah.
So what do you think of both the issues, the military escalation and the option of negotiating with the leaders of the Taliban?
Thank you for the question. It's very interesting. I think they are both. They are connected, because I'm convinced if you gain some results on the ground, so you are more strong. You are in condition to treat after. When I was kidnapping, and also the day, the years before when I was there, the words of negotiation was forbidden, because nobody talking about negotiation. Now they starting to talk about this. There is a difference, because there is two position, two lines inside the coalition. There is some countries want to negotiate with all. Another part of the country of the coalition wants to negotiation only with some leaders of the Taliban. But I think the surge, the decision of Barack Obama, the President Barack Obama, is important. It's different, obviously, like approach, like what was the approach of the past administration, but I think it's necessary to create this surge, because with more soldiers on the ground, I think you are right to conquer more territories, more strong position. And from this position, you can to negotiate from a strong position. So it's different, and I think this, because I am sure when about your you remember my declaration, because I know, yes, I've been only 5 years in Afghanistan, but I'm sure that the majority of Afghan people, they don't withdraw to the Taliban regime. They want now they are really more open with the people. You can imagine with the two big revolution, like the internet and the web, the mobile phone, they open to the world. There is many internet points, also in the village, very far away from Kabul, from other city, And the people, I think, they know there are many people who's coming from the exile outside, so they live in the United States, in India, in Pakistan. So there is the people don't want to remain to the Middle Age state that remained during the Taliban regime. But I think the presence of more soldiers is in reality is the score is only if we gain some results on the ground. After that, it's possible to negotiate. But in the same time, I think if we don't have a deadline, because it's not possible to remain for more years, probably we have to stabilize the deadline, because how long we can to remain in this condition. And I think also which kind of disaster produce, you can imagine the bombarding, the civil casualties, they produce rage in the populations. The population, obviously, they don't support the Taliban. But when the Taliban arrive in the village, destroyed by the bombarding with a lot of dead person, obviously, you know, this is provoked by the presence of foreign forces. And so it's necessary also military strategies to begin very, very precise. And I think the actual chief of the forces there is General McChrystal. He pay very attention, he's take very attention about what is a raid before. I think since the last years, they producing a lot of casualties. This is obviously is against all the efforts that try to do, you know, on the ground with the context of the popular civilization, because you can imagine after 9 years, the people are they starting to see with some suspect all these forces, and they say, okay, it's 9 years you are here, and the country remains the main state, and there is many presence of French forces. There is always raid, and the risk is the Taliban can have more forces, and so it's very important, I think, to produce some score, some in the ground, in the same time with a strong position you can to negotiate after. So I think the two elements are connected.
Thank you. And my last question before giving the floor to the audience is regarding your job. You reminded us correctly that after your kidnapping and your release, other Western correspondents were kidnapped, including a journalist of the New York Times. This is becoming this kind of job. You were, by the way, you were a war correspondent even before Afghanistan. Yeah. You were a war correspondent in Lebanon.
Yes.
And in Iraq.
Yeah.
Right. The question basically is, will there be war correspondents in the future? As kidnappings become more and more frequent, for our governments, you are, people like you are trouble.
Yes.
You are definitely trouble. Maybe also for our publishers, you are trouble.
Yeah, sure.
There's you are a big liability.
Exactly.
For a newspaper. So in the future, will there be only embedded war correspondents, and is it possible to provide a thorough and balanced information about ongoing wars when you are an embedded correspondent?
Yes, I think the first thing that I thought when I was freed, because I verify what impossible is. The world was changing. Also, our our job. Our job is changing for many reasons. So, but I think as a war correspondent, we make this job for the last 10 years, the last 7 years, and it was really a limit, because also in Iraq they're starting to kidnap the journalists. So the journalists, I think, they was killed, they was injured them for always in the story. But they starting with a kidnapping, I think, is the last 7 or 6 years also in Iraq. If you remember, many person, many journalists also. So I think it's not possible to make the same job like before, because I was lucky to work with some big editor like Eugenio Scalfari, like Montanelli, was a mythical journalist for the Italian press, and they learn us to go in the ground, to go in to exactly to see what happens, because I think the confidence is a relationship with my lector, the people use to read what I write, and I think it's based on what the reality, what the truth, what I write. So it's necessary to go in the different situation and to describe the reality of the situation, but it's not possible to describe the ground as a war like before. And it's not only my case, there is many cases about this, and also recently. And so I think it's changing, probably, if you know, also now, we know a lot of things about Afghanistan. I think, yes, we have some news. There is some correspondent staying in Kabul, writing what happens, with kind of news arriving by passing by from the different army. But in reality, I think there are few journalists who stay in the ground, stay embedded with the different army of a different country. But what you see, yes, you assist some little battle, but in reality, you are not in condition to describe exactly what happens in the ground. And so I suppose it's a limit for the complete information, because we have no chance, we have not possibility, because we began a problem for our publisher and our country and our government. So, and also because we risk to be killed for really for an interview, I think the price is too big.
Thank you, Daniele. Thank you very much. So there's time for questions on the floor. I think that there's a microphone there. You can just your hand. Yes, please.
I was just wondering about the Afghan journalist who was serving as your translator. Did you all have a chance to talk during those 2 weeks about his fears that he might be treated differently? And if you could talk a little about your feelings about how he was treated differently.
Yes, obviously, we spent together just 2 weeks of captivity, so we talk a lot of... It was difficult because you understand the Pashto, but the Taliban saw there was surround us. They doesn't want to, and so when they look, we talk, they block me, after they stop and they say, no, you cannot talk. And the last days during the night, we talk, we confide, we crying together, and also we was some moments where we were very happy, because he understand at the last moment something the radio say they're freed us. And so he was convinced. Also Sayed Aga, the days when they killed, we talk together. He approached
the driver.
Me. Yes, the driver. He approached me and he say, oh, he was very, very, very sure would be released. And say, when we come back in Kabul, you help me to buy a new car, because they take me, so for me as a job. So also Sayed, so the driver, also Ajmal was convinced. We were released. Poor Sayed was killed in front of us, so we have no chance to save him. For Ashmal, it was more complicated. I think he's victim of a new chantage, as you say, chantage, le ricatto. You say,
blackmail.
A blackmail, yes, I think. So it was more complicated. And but we talk a lot. We talk a lot, and I am in contact with his family. We collect, obviously, a lot of money for his family, because it's a form that normally in the Afghan tradition to reimburse, not to give, like, how you say, a form of compensate this debt. But obviously for me, I lived for 2 years, and also sometimes now, maybe not with a big sense of guilty, obviously, no, because I lost my two person, it's normal, this. But I think if you have time and you have the passion to read this book, it's not a book, only a bloody book, horror book, but it's a book interesting, and inside we found it also some moments of conversation between me and Ashmal, and we talk about a lot of things. Yes, please.
This experience changed your perception about your own job. I remember when Juliana Sgrena was released that she had an article saying that for her would have been difficult, at least in the initial phase, to think about coming back in a workplace and being again a reporter of war. So how, if I may ask, that changed your own perception about your own duty at the job as a journalist?
I know very well Juliana Sgrena. The story of Juliana Sgrena, I understand, is different, because all the stories are different. Juliana Sgrena decides to write another book and coming back in Iraq because he's an Italian journalist, is kidnapping also her. And I was there with her. We take our breakfast together. She asked me, okay, we go to there. I say, no, Juliana, I don't know. I don't feel it's not good. You know, it depends on the fate, really. But I think obviously your life changed. But I was convinced it's necessary to consider this story like really an accident in your career, in your life, and also if it changed your life, your scale of value, obviously, because it's changed. But at the same time, I think it's necessary to restart again. And to consider maybe my time in this land, my time in this planet is not finished. I have to stay here to do many things, no, probably they decide. So also to write this book. And so to start again the same job, because we like to do our job, to make a journalist is not a normal job, I think. It's very complicated job, very hard, very difficult, more difficult. And so, but I love this job, so I want to stay to do the same. Obviously, I finish with the war, because 7 years of war, 7 years of blood, there are many friends, journalists who came in this night, we work together, he knows very well also in Lebanon, like Antonio Carlucci and the other friends. And so after 7 years, the bombing, the blood, the injuries, the dead, it's not normal dead, but you can imagine in what condition. So I think it's a burn you, so it's necessary to stop. And so I think a new job, like journalist, but now I make it not the same, but I'm always a journalist, this is important, with a totally different vision of the life of the world also. Yes, please.
Did you notice during your captivity if the Taliban have connection with Pakistan? And do you think if the United States and the international coalition start talks, they have to integrate the Pakistan and even the India if they want peace?
But the Pakistan use the Taliban. They invented the Taliban. the Pakistan user, obviously, because the Pakistan has enormous influence from the south, about the south of Afghanistan. And they use, many years ago, 10 years ago, they created the Taliban as forces to control part of Afghanistan. It's not because they need to control part of Afghanistan as for to break more power for the main problem. The main problem of Pakistan is not Afghanistan, but is Kashmir. The Kashmir is the territory between India and Pakistan. So, but if they control the part of Afghanistan, they have more territory, so they are more strong. And but as they use, the Taliban, and they play with the Taliban inside. They finance the Taliban is officially with Saudi Arabia, and for other reason, Saudi Arabia was the two country who recognize immediately the Taliban regime were Pakistan and Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia because it's traditional, the main country of Islam, and so for religion motive, more religion reason, as they recognize. And I think, yes, the second question about the integration of...
Yes, the United States and the international coalition start talks with the Taliban.
I think this is a project. This is a want. We're talking about this project. There is two lines. One line say we have to talk. All the person say, okay, we start with the negotiation. But which kind of negotiation and with who? So there is one line who says we have to talk just with some chief of Taliban, right? Because Taliban are not one alone. Taliban is different groups with different position who control different part of the country. And so there is one position who say we talk only with the Taliban's who want to talk, want the reality. They are without weapons. They want the reality. They're looking for peace. Another part would say we don't talk with the other. They're more radicalist and more extremist than the condition. And the other say no, we have to talk with Zol. And because if we leave some groups, this group at the end, they are dangerous because we are involved at all. But we're starting with talking about the possibility, eventually negotiation. But at the moment, I think there are only secret contact. But they're starting. We're talking about negotiation, yes.
I have a general question. Since we are at the Italian Cultural Institute, you're two Italian journalists associated with La Repubblica. But I'm wondering specifically with you, where you were in a situation where you were very physically deprived of liberty, and therefore of liberty of the press of a certain type, then to go back to Italy, where there's a great deal of controversy about freedom of the press. Going from the situation where you were physically deprived of freedom to a situation in Italy where there is, you know, a kind of a psychological coercion or perhaps more constraining freedom of the press, does it seem exaggerated to you? Do you feel this sort of a greater commitment toward freedom of the press after your situation, or do you think there's a kind of exaggeration about the dangers to the press today?
Well, I think it's very interesting, that question. I think, you know, the freedom of the press is the freedom of the people. So I think, you know, the country, if you consider also Israel, where I work a lot of time, the press is very strong against the government, and very strong. There is a big opposition. In Italy, I think we have our anomaly in Italy is that we have a television, control of the television in the hands of one single group. This single group is connected with our prime minister. And so this is a condition. He have also parts of the paper editory. So this is an anomaly. Anomaly, you understand what I say, so it's typical. And this produce, I think, more that, not freedom, I think, it produce a concentration, anomaly concentration. There isn't here in the United States of the control of the press, so of the TV. You know very well the broadcasting is very important for advertising, for let advertising, from the control of the rights of different from the movies. And so this when we struggle for, or we hear about the freedom in Italy, I think there is very few newspaper freedom. I think our group, La Repubblica Western Express, is one of the group who struggled for the freedom, but we are alone with very few newspaper. But also maybe it's a consideration Federico, he knows very well.
Well, just a few words for those American friends tonight who might know more about Afghanistan than about Italy.
Yes.
So full disclosure requires us to tell that in Italy, La Repubblica is it's the largest national daily newspaper based in Rome. The publishing company of La Repubblica publishes also a weekly magazine, L'Espresso, and
TV.
We have a TV outlet, radio network, and we are not only controlled by Prime Minister Berlusconi, but we are also the main and sometimes only liberal opposition newspaper. So that although we have been for years as a newspaper in our coverage of the Italian political situation, as well as in our editorials, very, very critical of Mr. Berlusconi and very worried about the excessive concentration of media power, as well as financial power and political power in the hands of Mr. Berlusconi. Nonetheless, we have been able to criticize him freely. And this makes a lot of difference between Italy and other countries where you have no freedom of the press. And tonight we are speaking. We are both journalists of La Repubblica, and we are speaking inside a building owned and operated by the Italian government.
Exactly.
So that means that there's a fine line between being very critical and worried, and but still not. There's no confusion possible between Mr. Berlusconi and countries and governments that are outright suppressing press freedom.